might have seen the initial schedule. I was supposed to give this talk on the first day itself. So in a way, I hope it is still relevant because it's more of an introduction to machine learning, maybe with a few case studies added. So it's possible that it may not exactly fit into the right sequence, especially after a nice, interesting talk you had on the tools which are provided by ArcGIS. So this is really not tool-oriented kind of a talk, more of a conceptual, fundamental kind of thing, and how you apply deep learning or machine learning to some interesting problems, what are the challenges, and what kind of a roadmap one should look forward to. So basically, while talking about these, I may not have too much of orientation towards spatial analytics, although I have been working in the area of geospatial data analysis and processing. When at IIT Bombay, we had a special lab set up for geospatial information science, and there were a number of projects that we did in the areas that you have been talking about. So I'm not really going to go into the deeper aspects of spatial analytics, but talk really at the level of applying these tools and these techniques and methodologies to inferring some interesting aspects about the data. So that is, I'm sure by now you understand what is data science or data analytics or data mining or deep learning, and I mean all those fancy terms that you hear. So I just will go through the initial few slides just to establish the terminology between us so that we speak the same language, although I'm sure you would probably know those things by now. So can this go back also? Okay, this is not going back. Okay. And it's going forward. Okay. So we have the data, of course. I mean the getting the data seems to be the easier part today because there are technologies which do data collection everywhere. And we have, especially in the spatial context, we have lots of sensors that collect this data. So we have the ways of collecting the data, we have the technology to store and process the data. What we have learned, I'm sure over the last few days, is that the real requirement is that we build models which will give us some insight into what is happening in the real world processes or the real world data. So this is the analysis that we want to focus on. And we are looking for what you may call novel, valid, useful, and understandable models. So for example, it should be novel. It should add something new to you and something which it should not be something which is intuitively obvious. So for example, in many banks and other places, I have seen that many of the conclusions which are drawn are something which are routine. What we are looking for while doing analysis, data mining or deep learning, is to arrive at some patterns which are not intuitively obvious, which will allow me to intervene in the real world processes and to exploit those processes for better results. So we are looking for novel, valid. We need to test them that they're correct. And I think the important thing is that they should be understandable. Unless the model is understandable, you cannot drive it to benefit from the real world processes. Now, I think this is an important point that I will also talk about later. So there are models, for example, the neural network model. Is neural network model understandable? Even a regression model, is it understandable? And because that would also explain what I mean by understandability. So suppose, since you mentioned that, I work with many banks. So banks give loans. Loans default. Right? I mean, there is a probability of loan being defaulting. Payment may not come. Now, I have a lot of data about previous loans, good recoveries, some bad recoveries, and therefore, I expect that I will be able to build a model to find out what is the likelihood of a new loan defaulting. Now, if I have a model, which is, let's say, assume that is a neural network model. You feed the data, push the data into that, and it says 80% probability of a default. What is it that, you know, what is the intuition behind this? Can I understand? Is it because of his earnings? Because, let's say, he works in a poor backward area? I mean, unless the model is understandable, we cannot intervene. And that is very frequently an important application of the data science. So there are you can divide the applications into two categories, where you can apply the models without understanding. Any example of that? No, they have very well-defined rules, and you have an insight into that. Those rules give you insight into the person's behavior, right? So very often, in fact, that is important for CIBIL in credit rating. For example, say you want to recognize a human face, right? That does not need a model, the understandable model. The neural network is perfect for that, right? It can compare and try handwriting. Those recognition kind of things are a good example of applications where you just take the data and apply it. But you have a large number of applications, and I'll just mention a few later on, where this understandability of the models is important. And I think I broadly divide these applications of data analysis into two categories, where you want to act and where you simply want to use the data and use the models. Right? So keep that important differentiation. Okay, so there are two types of broadly the mining that you do. They're called predictive and descriptive. The descriptive gives you the insights, okay, about the real world parameters, like, you know. So I hope you have had time, other modules which have covered these, right? Okay. So I'm going to take examples where I applied these, and see whether they give us an handle, on the real world processes. So just description is not enough, right? So for example, I mean, you have heard of this very well known example, let's say the e-commerce applications and the marts use, how to stock your items. What is the probability of one item in which I am interested leading me to another item which I may buy without being interested in that? Now, those are the association rules, and they describe based on the past data, and you are able to act on that. Right? And these are also understandable models. They define the frequency with which they have occurred, the predictability, the support, and things like that. So you use these models to understand the real world and also to be able to use them to predict the performance in the future. So usually what we do is we of course have the data, a lot of data to begin with. And even what data you collect is also, it also requires understanding of the domain. You know, very often we believe that data is simply available and you have to create the model. So let me give an example. So recently, you know, there has been a lot of discussion on the economic downturn and so on, right? That, you know, there is not enough consumer interest buying and so on. So when Diwali came, people collected this data. So what is the weekly withdrawals from the banks? Okay. So weekly withdrawals, they found that if you compare with similar weeks of previous years, in fact, it is better than the previous years. So which pointed to the fact that money is being withdrawn and being consumed. So there is no indication of economic downturn. So in this case, the data which was taken was simply the week of the Diwali this year, amount withdrawn from the bank, and for previous years also. And it seemed to be, you know, rising. So things should be good. Except that when somebody pointed out that this week also happened to be the first week of the month, right? And that is the time when people withdraw the salaries, right? So therefore, what is important is the insight, and the kind of data you collect has to be relevant to the model, which means some basic understanding of the model itself is important. what are the relatively important parameters in order to really define an appropriate model. Sometimes you may simply miss the most important parameters which have influence on your output variables. So even this step cannot be done in the absence of a model. You need to, of course, do a major amount of cleaning, pre-processing, and understanding. In fact, I will briefly indicate this in one case that we were doing for agriculture data. And we collected data from one university which was working with farmers. And the data required so much of effort to put it in a normalized form which can be visualized and which can be processed further for the mining operation. And of course, you need a basic understanding of the data for which you do your descriptive statistics. You get a feel for the data. And then only when you have some feel and some visual understanding of that data, you can actually do some further processing, remove irrelevant variables from that, reduce the number of dimensions of your problem, and then determine what model to apply. Multiple models may be applicable. You need to see which one will do a good job. So this is overall approach to any data analysis task. And of course, there are these three basic learning styles that you must have already seen, that supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. So we take examples of these, and some of these techniques are the well-known for which you have libraries, whether you're talking about Python or any other library, these or R, they all support different types of techniques that you need to apply. So just to see, I hope you have seen all of these, right? And since I come from computer science background, very often my interest is in refining these algorithms and techniques to fit better in the context of my problem. So I am going to take a few examples of each of them, and just to make those examples little better understandable, let me just quickly do a recall for the two techniques that I am going to use. One is the regression, where you try to define a linear relationship between the output parameter and the input parameter. So you try to work out some equation, and this equation gives you the relevance of different variables, their impact on the output, right, and expresses a relationship. So you try to fit a model which is expressed in the form of an expression, and you try to keep the predictors, which are these known variables, x1, x2, etc., as few as possible, so that your model has focus on the relevant dimensions of the problem. So dimensionality reduction is probably one of the most important tasks before you apply the model. So are these x1, x2, etc., up to xn, how many of them should be taken? Some of them, in fact, you must have seen this in the discussions on regression, that not only we need to filter out irrelevant predictors, but correlated predictors also should be removed, because they tend to have a more influence on the model. So you need to remove uncorrelated variables, and you need to also find how good is the model. So you have estimates which actually predict or which define the error between the actual and the predicted values. So these are the well-known parameters using which you do the analysis of the model. How good is the model? So this is a regression technique. Then you have the neural network techniques, where you have the basic concept of a neuron, and it takes parameters which are weighted with certain weights, and then you apply some transfer function and so on, which will try to produce an output, and these outputs then can be fed either through other layers of neurons, or they go into the output. So overall, you typically get a neural network in which you have input layer, output layer, and the hidden layers. So this as a model again requires a lot of iterations in order to find a good fit which is expressing the relationship between outputs and the inputs. You need to do a lot of experiments. So I'm going to give some examples of this. So rest of the presentation is really devoted to the case studies that we have done. So they may not come from your special domain, but I hope you find them interesting and relevant even from other aspects. Because ultimately, what we talk about here are not completely disjoint from the spatial domain. So the first one is ATM. So we are all familiar with the ATMs. ATMs are loaded with cash, and we withdraw from the cash. Each one has certain number of transactions happening every day. So managing the ATM cash is a very important problem for the banks. In fact, it is like any inventory problem. If you put too much cash in the ATM, then you are losing interest on that cash, right? And the cash is lying idle. If you put too little, there will be too many outages and customers may not be satisfied. They will go to some other ATM and your bank may face the charge. So there is a cost and benefit associated with properly loading the ATM with the required cash, for which you need to have a model of demand on that cash. So you have to define this model which will explain the relationship between the amount of transactions which happen, the amount of cash which should be loaded. There is also the cost of loading. A van goes with guard and so on, and then there is a physical opening and replacement. So there is a charge that is applied for even filling the cash. So it's a cost optimization inventory type of a problem. And most banks have tried to come up with a good model. So efficient cash management, we want to understand and predict the demand and based on the past history. Now here itself, as you can see now, what kind of data should I collect? I need some domain understanding. Should it be just 1 week data, 1 month data, 12 month data, more than 12 month data? What would you suggest? Okay, so some festivals like Diwali, Christmas appear, right? So there are periodicities, and so for example, you may say I'll generalize this and I'll just call them as major events, minor events, and weekend may be minor event, there are lots of holidays that we have. I may classify them as category A, B, C, and so on, so that Diwali and Christmas don't get treated as two different but similar type of major events. So you might, you need to have some understanding of the data. I need to see the data before. So have I seen those variations? Are the variations at Diwali time significantly different from, say, any weekend or let's say national holiday or some such thing? If they are similar, then I can reduce the scope of my window. I can just maybe do 3 months kind of data. But if I see that, no, it's substantially different, and then even 2 years may not be enough, because if Diwali is a major event which has a completely different behavior, then for statistical stability of my data, for deep insight, I should have maybe even 10 years data, right? But in 10 years, behavior of people change, economy changes, right? Everything changes. So, it's not easy. So therefore, if I do not have a proper feel of the problem, it is unlikely that I will, I may start wrongly. I may actually try to fit a model for 12 month data and miss the periodicity that you were talking about. In fact, there is a, in Europe, a major competition was held by banks to invite scientists, data scientists, to propose an efficient model for the ATM cash replacement. They provided the data for 24 weeks, 24 months, 2 years, and they asked you to predict that based on that, make predictions for the next 2 months. And that was an open competition. In fact, so many new and refined algorithms were proposed that there was a full-fledged international conference on the different algorithms and which one does the best job. So in this case, this itself is an issue. And therefore, the maturity of the model, its applicability, its stability may be different from ATM to ATM, region to region, bank to bank. Right? So for example, you know, I have an ATM which is in, say, market area. Right? And I'm the only ATM right now, my, say, state bank. Tomorrow, 3 more ATMs come there. It has completely changed the data. And therefore, unless you factor that also, your model is unlikely to be able to predict. So the point of highlighting this is that these are the kind of changes which are important for building your model. Right? So what we did, you know, this we did for a bank which has more than 5,000 ATMs, and we had a lot of data available from them. Right? Again, do you build a single model for all the 5,000 ATMs, or do you create multiple models or one model for every ATM? Because yeah, it's being done with computers and you have lots of cloud facilities available. You can create one model for, or the ATM itself is a PC, and maybe a small model can run there itself. Now it becomes extremely complex to handle such real world problems in which banks will invest. I mean, it's not just an academic study, but the bank will like to use this. The average cost, the cash that they manage in ATMs, most banks is about of the order of 300 to 400 crores. So it's a lot of saving that they can do by doing proper cash management. So here is some data that I'm just showing, the kind of data which was available in the input. This was coming from the ATM switch, the customer ID, the ATM ID, date, time, and amount withdrawn. Very straightforward. But this data needs to be extended in order to make it amenable for modeling based on the parameters I think are important. Right? And what we felt is that the date and the importance of that date needs to be captured. So we actually extended this, and as you, some of you said, I need to know what is the day of the week, is it a holiday, is it a day before holiday? Because very often, if tomorrow is the holiday, I try go and withdraw the money today. Right? Then is it a salary day? Is it a salary plus one, salary plus two? Is it a Friday, Saturday, Sunday? So we actually introduced a lot of these variables without really knowing whether we are overloading the model, whether some of them are related or not related. But in order to first do that, you need to really get some kind of standard statistics to get a feel of the data. So we tried that, right? And we had fairly huge number of transactions. We actually scaled the data for making it amenable to the modeling. We used a lot of exploratory statistics to get a feel of the data. Right? So for example, this is just a box plot that you tell, which typically tells you, how on different days of the week the transactions vary. What is the mean total withdrawn amount on that day, right? And what is the max? What is the mean? Where is the median? And so on. So you can see that yes, there is a variation from day to day. Right? But is it similar from week to week? Is it similar from first week of a month to the last week of the month? All of this basic understanding. You just can't take the data and stuff it into a library routine and say, give me a neural model. You need to do a lot of homework before you can fit the model to this. So we actually created a regression models, and we did multiple models. It could be on a day-wise withdrawals, week-wise withdrawals. Our model may predict weekly demand rather than a daily demand. So just to see which of them will explain my historical data. Okay. So we got models which where some of them were not satisfactory, some of them were okay, 5 to 20% error, right? And believe me, many banks were not impressed with that. They said, you know, I just have a gut feeling that this ATM average demand is this much. I will, based on that average, I will load it for 3 days or 4 days, and that is enough for me. So unless they can, you can prove that this model is better than their heuristic or, you know, intuitive model, they are not going to use it. I gave the same problem to my students recently, and everybody is now thrilled with neural networks, right? So they said, we'll apply the neural networks, and they said, what is the latest version of that? Oh, the recurrent neural networks, okay? So they said, we'll apply this, and you know, and here, of course, these are the neural networks which have an internal memory, and they have a past record. So again, you know, it's not enough to say I'm going to apply a neural network. There's so many variations of that, right? And within a single neural network model itself, there are so many options to choose to see that you don't get a bad model, also to see that you don't get an overfitted model, right? So they preferred this algorithm, thinking that it has proven itself very nicely for the time series data. This is ultimately time series data. So they chose a model, and they decided on how many layers they will have, how many neurons they will have, what will be the window. So they said, okay, you know, they did not really bother about all those so many days, different types of days that I created. They said, we'll just use past 10 days data to predict the 11th day's data. For training, they said, we'll do 100 iterations, epochs, so that the neural network will try to stabilize the output by modifying the weights internally. So when I create that neural network model, the weights have to be arrived at. So you need to really fine-tune that. So you can create more epochs which will converge to a maybe more stable kind of a thing. So they actually, you know, they were very happy with the result, as you can see here, that their forecasted data was very close to the original data for few ATMs that they have tried. So I just gave, because, you know, naturally the same model will not work for all ATMs. There may be ATMs in an institution, ATM in a rural area, ATM which is connected to a bank, ATM which is offside the bank. You know, there are so many categories of these that you cannot naturally have a single model. So then they said, okay, let's see whether other models are equally good. So this average model that most banks talk about, right, they will take the last few days averages, and they found that there was a tremendous variation between the predicted and the actual value. Exponential smoothing is typical technique that you use for inventory management, and you use different exponents here to arrive at the predicted time series. So again, in some cases, you know, with lower values of the alpha, which is an coefficient here, you see a lot of mismatch. But then this is something which you try and error-based thing, you know. So they found that, okay, with alpha equal to 0.9, they got a much better kind of a result. So the point is that there is a experimentation involved in modeling. There is a paper that SBI had published, some people from SBI, and they prepared the similar model just taking 3 months data, and they used a prediction. So this was the training data of 3 months, and 15 days was the test data. And unsurprisingly, they had a very good match, and they developed a model which was 5%. But, you know, one ATM, 3 months, the study did not say anything about what happens if you go beyond 15 days. Right, and what happens if you go to some other ATM. So this was more like an academic paper, but what I'm trying to point out is that studies have been sponsored, and you know, they can lead to some interesting results. But what important lessons that one can take from here is that, firstly, you can do the modeling only when there is a statistical stability in your processes that you are modeling. Right? If a lot of things are happening and you are not even aware of that, new ATMs come, right? Or suddenly government has put restriction that you can't withdraw more than 3 transactions without paying something. You know, that always has an impact. Or you cannot go to any other ATM because there is a charge. So these factors, if they are not modeled properly, they will not explain that, you know, there will be much more error. So such statistical stability nowadays is very difficult to find in the real world. So you really must understand whether this is satisfied by your technique. Of course, the other thing is, you know, the seasonal characteristics, and also the real world itself changes, you know, with age, the spending habits change. So nowadays, you know, we older generations always carry cash in our pockets. The newer generations don't, right? So actually the demand for cash has completely changed. So nobody should build a model which on a data which is 5 years old. It's meaningless probably. That is how the world changes. So data mining has to have a good insight and good understanding of all these things. We had another case study which is more of your spatial type, you know, and you know, it was related to classifying the cyclone data in order to be able to classify them into different categories and predict their landfall and things like that. So this is the spatial data, and obviously the first few slides only talk about why it is important and why you want to do this, you know, so that it can be used for prediction purpose. That the next time you can see where it has originated, how it is moving, what are its speed and other things, curvatures, whatever you talk about, and based on that, see if it falls into one of the classification categories that you have, and based on that, predict its movement. So that was the idea. So the student collected lot of data and sort of plotted, and you can see that it looks like something which doesn't seem to have any statistical stability, or the way there are taken together, they don't seem to explain anything. So maybe what you need to do is further classification on different parameters, right? So what my student did was that group them into certain categories, right, and see if we can explain these different things. So it's primarily a classification technique that is applied for this data using your what you call KNN kind of algorithm. So you have to decide what is K. Should you classify it into 5 categories, 10 categories, etc. And based on the nearest neighbor, which are, in this case, of course, nearest neighbor means very similar kind of movement. So a lot of data was available, but at the interval of 6 hours, right? And we selected some, subset of the data that was available. So totally some 139 events were studied. And this is how they look like, right? So even now doesn't, so given this, you now really need to experiment with your K, right? Should I divide it into 10, 5, 4, and see whether it does a good job, apply some error function, and then maybe change the value of K, right? So something of that iterative work has to be done. So what we really did here was, take into account the curvature and the origination and a few more attributes for each cyclone. So we have the cyclone tracks, and we looked at the first and second moment based on how they are moving, And therefore, a vector of 5 attributes was created for representing each cyclone. And based on that, so this is how a typical track will be, you know, analyzed in order to find its curvature and the center of gravity, centroid of that, and that vector was prepared. Right? So then based on that, you can apply your classification algorithms. And I think in this case, the student was able to get 5 different clusters, and they had different originations, different movements, different landing, different curvatures, and so on. And so it seemed to be a good classification that she was able to achieve with some kind of trial and error. So these are the different sets which are quite well clustered compared to the overall thing. And then she classified them based on their lifespan. So different clusters fall into different lifespan, how much they would be active for, and they're based on their wind speed. So you have these box plots for each of these different characteristics and for each of the classes. So you can see that from class to class, the behavior of the wind speed is quite different. Seasonality. So can be a very interesting study. What we have really done here, and of course it's in the environment, whether the next one will emulate one of these 5 categories is not sure. It may be forming the 6th category by itself. So you need to check as more and more events happen whether your model and classification is still correct, and otherwise you may have to refine that further. So that is something that will evolve with time. The third one is really not a data mining application. In fact, we started with that objective, but then we said it doesn't look like something that would work in real world. We were actually working with one NGO who was interacting with farmers, and they said that we'll be an intermediary for helping them with the advice that we can give. So the predicting was not an goal here, but to be able to advise the farmers. Now, I'll tell you why exactly we chose this based on the interaction that we had with the agriculture university and the kind of input that they gave us. It looked like things are so dynamic that it will be difficult to carry models based on the historical data, but there are so many changes are happening. So I'll just summarize that. But what I had mentioned earlier, they had huge amount of data, right? Data which was related to farm, soil, sowing, when it happened, different activities that they carried out, the cost, the yield, everything was captured by them during the sowing and the entire period of farming, and for few years. Typically, every village they had 2 to 3 years data before the seed and the other things changed. So what basically the input that we got was that these universities and the various seed making industry, they are constantly innovating, they're making changes. Right? And in fact, that university was bringing out books explaining the new seed varieties and the kind of cultivation cycle that they need. So they said it's something that constantly happens, and all of them have a short life cycle. So why not we create an advisory based on their research experiment? So before the seed is put out to farmers, there's a lot of work that they do, and a lot of studies that they make based on what is the best way, and they create the guidelines. So we wanted to capture those guidelines into the we tried to develop an ontology for every kind of plant and its biology and its cultivation and yield and diseases and so on. So in this case, we captured the different aspects of the plant biology and its best practices for growing that crop. So we developed these ontologies. Basically, ontology is primarily the relationship between the cause, effects, and the different types of concepts that you have. So for example, this captures the activity related ontology. What are the typical activities that happen in that particular seed, right? And then, you know, what are the further characteristics of those? So all this data was generalized and captured. Then we had diseases ontology, which explained what kind of issues come up, at what frequency, at what time, and you know, so those related to things. We had generic disease ontology and we had very specific disease ontology. So this ontology was actually capturing the agriculture domain knowledge, and that domain knowledge was to be used for advising the farmers. So we built a kind of a platform and a tool where we had the ontology, the way the meaning, the basic concepts work, and we had the database of ongoing things in the farm and also the environment and so on. And basically we provided search techniques which may be based on keywords, which may be based on questions, and where we had an efficient search method which will correlate not just the query coming from that farmer and coming from the latest data from that, but it will try to consolidate data across farmers, across region and so on, so that you can actually predict the issues which are happening on the field. So we were quite happy with the way it evolved, but our focus being computer science was more on, you know, we didn't really understand the domain. We got the help from the agriculture university people, but idea was to develop that ontology and a good search facility. So search is not just the textual kind of a search or a typical Google kind of keyword search, but the search actually correlates the knowledge, right, across those different ontologies and tries to explain to the farmer what is happening and why it is happening. So basically, summarizing, what I find is that idea is to put the big data to use, and that naturally depends on the understanding of the domain. And sometimes, and probably the most of the times, you would like to intervene so that you can actually guide the whole process on the right path. And of course, there are a large number of algorithms, and model building is the most challenging thing. And what I find very often is that in many domains, they just hire data scientists who know the code and the libraries and the algorithm. But unless you have that kind of domain understanding, should I use 5-year-old data? Does it have a statistical stability? That kind of thing. And whether we have captured all the models, it requires a good domain understanding. So it cannot be separated from domain people. Of course, one has to be aware of overfitting, and probably the most important, confounding variables, which we have missed completely. Right? So all these are the important things. Now, since we have initiated the data science areas and it's the things that everybody talks about, I thought I'll leave you with some good books to read. Right? So. I have you seen this book? Yeah, some of you have, right? So I think, you know, it tells you that even the data and its availability and its analysis is going to change the way we think about the science, right? And earlier, the science was based on, you know, observations, theory, making axioms, and then proving them, and so on. Now, you may just say that I'll do So whenever I throw the stone up, it will come down, not because of gravity, but because that is what I see it happening all the time. So that could be the approach to the science. Of course, we will not be happy, because I think, don't think science will move much if it happens like this. This is a new book which I really enjoyed reading, and I hope you find time, or you've seen this, called Homo Deus. In fact, Sapiens is another book written by the same author. You know, so he says that a new religion is taking place, the religion of what he calls dataism. And so here he says, up to this, data was only seen as the first step in a long chain of intellectual activity. Now we are reversing the whole process. Right? And the intellectual activity now begins by analysis of the data and not by creating hypotheses. You know, I think that was one of the typical human activity, that we will express our insight in the form of some hypothesis. Now we probably find no need for doing that. And if we apply data analytics and mining so blindly, that we may really lose our understanding of the process and be simply driven by the data. So data is, that is, the people who follow this religion are skeptical about human knowledge and wisdom, and prefer to put their trust in big data and computer algorithms, okay? So this was one. I mean, a very, very interesting book, and I am recommend it very strongly. Then I found this. Some well-known data scientists also had hesitation. Says data-driven science is a failure of imagination. Of course, in some cases, I am sure you would agree with that. But of course, you know, it cannot be black and white to such an extent. But yes, you cannot delink it. Imagination is a typical human activity for expressing and understanding processes, and I think we should not be driven blindly by data analysis. I found this book recently. In fact, the author is a very well-known computer science who has been awarded Turing Award. Turing Award is, you heard, it's like almost Nobel Prize of computer science. He works in the AI area. And in fact, he has done a lot of experiments on the Alan Turing's definition of intelligence. So he has written the Book of Why. In fact, what I said earlier, that if you want to intervene, you must ask why, and not just how and what. Right? Unless you ask the question why. So if something helps in curing a disease, or something happens, it's not just because I have huge amount of data. That is what clinical trial people do, right? And they say, you know, this works statistically on hundreds of patients. You know, there is a very well-known Indian author. He, of course, writes in all the newspapers and so on. He says that because we do this, we will never personalize medicine, because the medicine has to work on a large population. But we are not all same. And therefore, unless you ask why, you may not be able to get into the root of the problem. So he said some people would see data mining as the finish rather than the first step. What he does, he actually creates a ladder of causation. What will explain, you know, basically, the cause and effect is different from statistical correlation. Right? We may be able to correlate and say, oh, the correlation coefficient is 0.8, 0.9. That is one way of looking at it. But if you want more insight, you must look at causation. And causation, you understand when you ask the question why. And he actually creates this. So he says, if you just want to look at only the data, at most you can look at association. But if you want to intervene, you do the data learning and so on, but you start asking the question why, right? And you can create counter scenarios only when you understand these processes. So he actually says that ultimately every model should lead to a cause diagram, that these are my quantities, or important parameters. This is the relationship. This is how they impact the real world, and so on. So these three books that I have been reading recently, I think you would love to read them, because we are going to work in this area. We are going to drive projects in this area. We are going to have a lot of expectations from this area. So it's important that we understand them properly. Thank you.
First of all, I would like to thank you for giving us such a good lecture on the background of machine learning, and because a lot of the times, even in our domain, I mean, we just build the models, and simply in many of the companies, we don't have time to go through that background.
Spoil the fun very often.
Sir, regarding the problem of that ATM machine cache management, sir, did you like check the performance?
Performance in what sense?
Performance between
the model's ability to predict.
Yeah, the comparison between linear and non-linear models. Like, did you get any insight about where was the non-linear model breaking down, or?
See, basically, we tried two models. One was the linear regression model, right? The other was neural. Now, neural is something which you cannot describe either non-linear or linear, right? We do not really understand what is happening. So it really doesn't explain anything about the how the quantities are interrelated. So the only way you can check, see, in regression, at least you know what is the weightage and whether some parameters are just spurious or they have a deep insight, right? For example, if you use R, it tells you which attribute is playing better or more important role, and you can remove some, right, and redo the regression model. In neural network, you don't get that kind of insight. So it's not the only way you can apply it and measure it is treating it as a black box. So you have a test data, you apply the test data and see whether it's giving you good close match, right, and if it doesn't, you refine it. And typically overfitted models do that. So I'm not sure whether that SBI case study is an overfitted model, because it gave very good results, right? But we need to really apply it to many other domains. Thank you.
Actually, like for that same banking model,
Have you run out of cash?
No, we also now need to look at the panic buttons that are being pressed to banks.
Yes.
So, like the duration long also like is not right. Should be a short span also. Like these days, we get false alarms or real alarms that bank will only, you'll have to withdraw only so much amount of cash. Mm-hmm. So everybody starts withdrawing.
Yeah, these are incidences which are very hard to model.
Yeah.
Right. And they are one-off kind of incidences. Right. So that makes problem very hard. But then, you know, if excluding that, if I have still a stable model, I will build one, because these are things which are very hard to, and I might create a category which is sort of unknown event, and just be prepared. Nothing will prepare you for these.
Correct.
So it might as well remove them for more.